Señoras y señores, bienvenidos a mi canal. Hoy les traigo uno de los bateristas más importantes de la historia. Él es multiinstrumentista, educador, compositor y productor. Ha trabajado junto a grandes artistas de renombre como Falco, Robbie Williams, Peter Gabriel, Glenn Hughes, Asia, Tina Turner, George Michael, Ozzy Osbourne, Paul Gilbert, and many more, y muchos más. Es fundador de la banda de metal progresivo Stork. También es fundador del Thomas Lang Drumming Bootcamp, The Big Drum Bonanza, y la escuela online de batería Thomas Lang Drum Universe. Y es el presidente de la Asociación Internacional de Percusión. Cuenta con más de 23 premios internacionales como Mejor Baterista, Mejor Baterista Clínico, Mejor Baterista de Estudio, entre otros. So, I would like to introduce you the one of the greatest drummers in the history of the world. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome, Thomas Lang.
Hola, señoras y señores. ¿Cómo está?
Great. So, this is going to be the first question of this interview. I would like to know about your beginnings, which was the main reason that you decided to become a drummer.
Okay. Well, I was 4 years old and I saw a drummer on television on a live music show that was broadcast one day a week, every Sunday at 7 p.m. There was a half hour live show where the Austrian Broadcasting Corporation invited international artists to come and perform live. And I remember seeing this drummer play on this massive blue sparkle drum set. He had like, you know, 15 tom-toms, and he counted in the song and he played a big drum fill in the song, and he seemed to be in control and in charge of the whole band. And I was intrigued because I thought the drums looked really cool, and he was the only one in the band sitting down, so I thought he must be the boss. Everybody else had to stand up and play guitar or whatever. Yeah. And I was just intrigued by that image. And I remember just a few days after that, because I had just seen a drummer who impressed me on television, we were out, my family and I, at a local music performance. It was kind of a fairground and there was a band playing. Mm-hmm. And because I had just seen this drummer, drums were on my radar and I was interested. So as the band was playing, I walked up onto the bandstand. It was a low stage, but I walked up onto that stage and I walked straight to the drum set while the band was playing and held on to the bass drum from the front while the guy was playing. And I just was blown away by the volume and the power of the drum. And visually, it was so exciting, all the chrome and the sparkly hardware and the fact that the guy was playing with all four limbs. I could see his feet moving and the hi-hat cymbal splashing, and I could feel the thumping of the kick drum against my chest, and I could feel the air pressure. And up there, he was playing cymbals and everything was moving, everything was loud. It was just like a complete sensory overkill. And that was the moment when I did, you know, was infected by the drum bug. I was right then and there, I knew that I had to play the drums and I wanted to do the same thing. And it looked fun, it sounded powerful. And for a four-year-old, that was just like, you know, a complete new revelation, you know. And and I bugged my mother right away to get me a drum set and get me, you know, to learn to play the drums. And she did, you know, literally a few days later, she found a local teacher and I had my first drum lesson maybe a week or so later.
That's awesome. So it was love at first sight.
Probably. Absolutely. Yes. We'll be right back.
The second question is, can you tell us about your first bands and what kind of music do you use to play with those bands? And yeah. How was your experience at the Vienna Conservatory of Music?
My first bands, well, you know, I was in music school with a local teacher, a drum teacher, and we had recitals. You know, once a year you have a little recital. So I was playing with, they weren't really bands, but they were sort of little orchestras and groups of musicians put together for recitals. So I don't count that. But when I was about 10 or 11 years old, I was practicing in my parents' basement and somebody just knocked on our door and said he's a guitar player and he heard there was a drummer. If he could meet me and we could jam. And he was much older than me. He was about 10 years older, and or at least 8 years old. He must have been like 18, 19 or something when I was about 10, 11 years old. And I met him and we started a band playing like 70s British rock, heavy rock band covers, like Deep Purple, you know, Led Zeppelin, and you know, kind of those kind of 70s hard rock songs. And that was my first band. And we played for probably about 2 years or so. Okay. And did maybe more, maybe 3 years. And we did some local gigs. I think my first gig was, I was probably 11 or so. And we played some local festival.
Who was the responsible for letting you hear Led Zeppelin and Deep Purple?
My mother was the one who was very, very supportive, who drove me to all the gigs and the rehearsals. And a lot of the music that we played, I was introduced by this guitar player guy.
Okay.
So my teacher wasn't really into Led Zeppelin or anything. You know, I was studying kind of jazz with him and Buddy Rich and, you know, Max Roach and those kind of things, and a lot of classical music. But this guitar player friend of mine, he introduced me to a lot of that British rock music. He brought all his albums and you know, lent them to me for me to listen to the music and learn the songs and play them correctly. So he was the one who really got me into that kind of stuff. And my mother was like super, you know, supportive in regards to all the logistics, you know.
Yeah, I think that's very important that your family, it has to be very supportive when you start playing an instrument in a very young age. You know?
Absolutely. I mean, it wouldn't have worked without that kind of support and that environment. And I was also very lucky to have a fantastic teacher locally where I lived. He was the chair of the Vienna Symphonic Orchestra, head chair of percussion. So he just happened to be living and teaching in that small town outside of Vienna where I grew up. So I was extremely lucky to find a great teacher, to have the support of my parents, and to have the right infrastructure around me and meet the right people early on who introduced me to music that I really enjoyed. Mm-hmm. So yeah, all these things came together.
Great. And the Vienna Conservatory of Music, how was your experience? Going there.
It was a great experience. I started studying there very early as a teenager while I was still in high school. I also attended the conservatory because my teacher kind of mentored me into the school early. Mm-hmm. And I really enjoyed the experience. I had several different teachers there, and it was really important for my musical growth. I learned to read, you know, in my first drum lesson, basically. My first teacher taught me how to read. So I was a pretty good reader by the time I entered the conservatory. And it was a really important experience because I got much deeper into jazz. I got connected to a lot of musicians there and formed a lot of different bands, trios, quartets, you know, quintets, all the way up to octets and big bands. And I played a lot of jazz and went through the real book and learned all the standards, played a lot of gigs with colleagues of mine from the conservatory locally in Vienna, and just gained a lot of, you know, gigging experience and musical experience. It was focused on jazz, mainly, the conservatory. But, you know, that was important for me. I enjoyed playing jazz. I enjoyed learning all the jazz independence, getting into, you know, brushes, and I really enjoyed connecting with a lot of other young musicians who were like-minded and also eager to go out and play concerts.
Experience happened? When did you start playing with his band?
Oh, I was also a teenager, really young, before I finished school even, so probably 16, 17, something like that. And it went on all the way from, you know, until he passed away in 98.
Oh.
So, and that also was an, you know, incredible experience. He was the biggest pop star in Austria.
Yeah, so many.
And worldwide, you know, he had worldwide success. So it was a really, again, formative and important experience because, you know, I learned to deal with a lot of new things, new equipment, electronics, programming, working with samplers and sequencers and computers and you know, I had to focus extremely on micro timing and precision and recording a lot, and that was a really great important experience for me musically as well.
Right. And when you decide to move to England,
when I was which year would have that been? 88, I think. Mm-hmm. So
80s. I remember you still have the long hair back then in that.
So yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly. I had, you know, throughout that whole period I had, you know, long hair and moved to London, and that again, you know, I got connected very, very quickly to a lot of great musicians in London.
Mm-hmm.
The first great connection I had was Billy Liesegang, who was a guitar player who played with David Bowie and did a lot of session work in London, and was also producer and writer. And I played on his solo records, and through that connection met John Wetton and Jack Bruce and Glenn Hughes, because they were all guests on Billy's records. Right after I did the session for Billy, like a week later, I was in John Wetton's band, you know, because he happened to be looking for a drummer, and also with John, and then started working live and touring with John. So, and was in John's band and John Wetton's band and Asia for close to 10 years or so throughout the whole 90s.
That's great.
Well, How are you? You all right? That was a song that was written while the pyramids were being built. And this one is kind of more around about Stonehenge time. It's called Soul Survivor. We'll be right back.
tell us about your influences? What are the drummers that make your identity? Because I know that we have to listen many, many styles to create an identity, you know?
My big first heroes were Buddy Rich and Ringo Starr.
Okay.
And then shortly after that, followed by Billy Cobham and Tony Williams.
Yeah.
And then a really huge influence was Stuart Copeland and Vinnie.
Yes.
And then all the other guys, you know, Terry Bozzio, Ian Pace, John Heisman, you know, and then all the fusion guys, Alphonse Mousson, Lenny White, again, Vinny, later Weckl, of course, and Peter Erskine, and you know, and I've gravitated towards virtuoso drummers, you know, drummers who had, you know, incredible control and great personality, like Stuart Copeland,
yes,
and Steve Gadd, you know, Neil Peart.
I saw a video of you playing with Stuart Copeland, like making in his house, probably. I don't know
where
it was. That was awesome. You were playing
it's great.
Percussion there. Yeah,
exactly. No, I was a huge fan, and I still am a huge fan because he's such a unique player. And I love drummers who have personality that are unmistakably, you know, themselves, like Stuart Copeland. You know, he sounds like nobody else. He holds the sticks differently. He uses different instruments, you know, octobons, splash cymbals, really high-pitched snare drums. And he, at the time, he used echoes and delays on his equipment, and he had these really hip beats that nobody else played. And he was so creative and has so much personality in his playing, and he would merge punk with reggae and new wave and rock, and he was just like all over the place, really innovative, really creative, and full of personality and totally unpredictable playing. And that's what I loved, you know? So, yeah, he was a huge hero of mine and still is. And, you know, although I know him now and he's a friend, and you know, I still have to pinch myself, you know, when I'm at his house or we jam together or something, you know, because I was such a nerd fan.
Yeah. What can you tell us about the drum methods? What are the main methods that a drummer, a beginner or probably advanced drummer, needs to learn or has to have, you know?
I think, that's a good question. Let me plug in my computer before it runs out of battery. One second, okay? Mm-hmm. I have to plug this in. I'm low on battery, one moment.
So the drum methods, which are the main or the most important methods that we have to have as drummers? I know there's
books?
One of your favorite books, I think, is the Jim Chapin.
Yes, mm-hmm. Absolutely. So I think obviously, you know, you have to get a great snare drum book. Stick control is always recommended, you know, you can't go wrong to learn rudiments and snare drum exercises with stick control. Another great snare book that I love and actually prefer to stick control is Master Studies by Joe Morello. I also studied out of NARD, which is the National Association of Rudimental Drummers, out of their books, and I practiced a lot of marching technique with various snare drum books from, you know, DCI. And also Bill Coxon's book, All American Drummer, is a great book. I studied out of that, and I studied a lot of snare technique with Viennese books, you know, classical books.
Yes.
Like Richard Hochreiner's Kleine Trommelschule is one of them. And then the other thing that's important, I think, in regards to methods is not just technique, but or hand technique, but independence and foot technique. Mm-hmm. And for independence, I practiced Jim Chapin's book, both of them, volume one and volume two. So Advanced Studies for the Modern Drummer, volume one, which is the blue book, the jazz independence book, and then the extended version, volume two, which is a really thick, incredible compilation of independence exercises. And New Breed, same thing. I love New Breed. One of my favorite books of all time. So I practiced that like crazy. And I also practiced four-way coordination, which is a fantastic book. And also the Dante Agostini independence books.
Okay. I never heard that one before, but I'm going to check it out.
Yeah. It's extremely advanced, Dante Agostini. And I practiced all of his books. So independence, syncopation, what's the other one? Reading, what was the other one? There's like a series of five or six books.
Okay.
Different colors. They all have the same kind of look, but different colors. And those books are incredible. So if anybody out there wants to get inspired, I can only recommend those books.
Another question is how you get in touch with Peter Gabriel, Tina Turner, those artists? How you get the gig?
Well,
how was your experience playing with those kind of artists?
I got connected through producers. So, through recording sessions, basically. Producers in London at the time who were just looking for session musicians. So I knew somebody who knew somebody who knew the producer, and I started working with them regularly, and they were the ones who were producing, major artists like, Tina Turner. So, people like Johnny Douglas, in London, and Trevor Horn, and Sam West Studios. I lived there for 15 years. So, and when somebody was looking for a session drummer to play on whatever, hit or artist, they were producing, I was lucky to be in that clique of people who got calls for sessions like that.
Hey guys, Thomas Lang here. I want to talk about my new online drum school, Thomas Lang's Drum Universe. I have hundreds of new exercises, a completely new curriculum that I've filmed over the last few months, literally hundreds of exercises, plus I'm adding dozens of new exercises every single month. So it's a really huge curriculum. I'm covering everything from hand technique to foot technique to independence, coordination, time playing, groove playing, tempo memorization, you name it. Hundreds of exercises of really interesting brand new stuff. And in addition to that, you can contact me via the forum on the website and ask me any kind of questions you have about drumming, or even upload your own video and I can then correct your mistakes if necessary, or just critique and evaluate your video and send you a video response back, so we can stay in touch this way, and it'll be a completely personalized and customized response to your video and to your question. So it's like having a private lesson with me. In addition to that, every month you can look forward to dozens of new exercises. It's a constantly growing and evolving website. It's very exciting. All brand new material. I think you're going to love it. And I'd love to see you as a subscriber on the site.
I have a question. The Thomas Lang Universe. What are the requirements to be part of the online drum school? Because many drummers here in Argentina, they want to learn from you. And we want to know how can you be part of the school?
It's very easy. All you have to do is sign up and pay your annual fee. I don't offer monthly fees because from experience that doesn't work out well for me or the students usually. And I offer a very cheap annual fee, which is $250 mm-hmm. For unlimited access to everything. And it's about 120 hours of exercises and lessons, plus, you know, performances, play along tracks, transcriptions, and so on. And that's the annual fee. And when you sign up for Thomas Lang's Drum Universe, you get Drum Channel subscription for 1 year for free, and vice versa. So it's really a 2-for-1, because Drum Channel, if you subscribe there, that would also be about $250 a year. So you, if you sign up for mine, you get Drum Channel for free, and vice versa. If you sign up for Drum Channel, you get access to Thomas Lang's Drum Universe for free for 1 year.
Well, the next question is related with recording, and we want to know what kind of drum heads you they are very good for recording, and what kind of drum heads are very good for live performances. I mean, what kind of drum heads do you use?
You know, that depends entirely on the type of music I'm recording. I have some sets that are that have only one ply, single ply heads with a white coating, so you get a more acoustic, a warmer sound for softer playing. I use single ply heads, like white coated ambassadors or clear ambassadors. And for heavier music, I use clear emperors and power stroke 3 heads on the kick drums and on gong drums. For like more vintage rock, I use black dot heads. Right. For really modern stuff, I use probably a combination of different heads, like clear snare drum heads without coating often, and probably, you know, emperors, or sometimes a combination of black dots, pinstripes, and emperors on different drums to get specific sounds. Sorry. I also often use smooth white heads, like on concert toms, for example. I always like to use black dot or smooth white emperors. They sound amazing. On my rototoms, I use pinstripe heads because I think they sound best with rototoms. So I always use completely different types of heads for different styles of music to achieve the most authentic sound for that style of music, and to get the best response from the head, the most resonance, and kind of the sound that I like. You know, if I go for something really 70s, and a muffled sound, I would use probably a coated two-ply head and lots of muffling. If I go for a modern rock sound, I use definitely uncoated clear heads.
Great.
So it completely depends. I change heads all the time, every day. And I have a lot of drums, like right now. I don't know if you can, well, I can show you.
Okay.
Like this kit, for example. I have clear emperors on this kit.
I love it.
And black dots on the rotor toms, and a P3 on the gong drum, also P3 on the kick drum on this one. But then I have a set over here where I've been recording sort of more jazzy things. And here, and this one has all coated heads.
Is that the carbon fiber drum set, or
no? This is a collector series the drum workshop.
Yeah, I saw a video the other day of carbon fiber drum head drum set. Sorry.
But yes, that's a PDP kit that I played recently. But here in my studio, I use all drum workshop drums.
Great. And can you tell us about the minor percussion and cymbals? How many years you've been using that brand?
I joined Meinl in 2000, so it's been 20 years.
Oh, that's great.
Yes, awesome. I must be one of the earliest endorsers who's still with them. And I love their cymbals, and I love the fact that they make percussion instruments as well. I use a lot of their percussion instruments, as you can see back up there. I've got my congas and djembes and bongos and stuff. I use a lot of their percussion instruments in the studio all the time, and all the shakers and hand percussion and even foot percussion stuff. All the, you know, they have an incredible series of wonderful percussion instruments and also incredible cymbals. And I think there's nobody better in regards to consistency of manufacturing, in regards to quality control, in terms of the selection of sounds you can get, the different series and the different alloys you can get. You know, they offer more than any other drum company in terms of metals, you know, alloys, you know, B8, B12, B20, FX9. So each one of those alloys has multiple series of symbols, you know, like if you go for B20, you have Byzance and Foundry and, you know, Vintage, all these different series, and each series has more sizes and shapes than any other company. So the selection and choices are, you know, absolutely incredible. And I always find everything I need.
Sonor drum, the drum kits, Sonor drum.
Yes.
When was the year that you changed to DW?
It was 10 years ago.
Oh.
So I was with Sonor for 21 years, and then 10 years ago I switched to DW. I love DW. They're my family. They're amazing drums. They make such wonderful instruments. Every detail of every drum, the finishes, the woods, the you know, the way the, that John Good came up with the science of the grain orientation and the mineral deposits in the wood and how they affect the sound, the cellulose density and the hardness of the wood, and how you, you know, when you cross laminate, you know, the different plies in certain ways, how that affects the sound. And nobody knows more about drum shell manufacturing and building than John Good. And on top of that, I think they have the absolute best hardware.
Yes,
and the best pedals of any drum company. Plus, you know, they're all really great friends. They're really close to where I live. Mm-hmm. And you know, it really feels like family. I'm very, very happy there.
And can you tell us about your experience of the Final Fantasy game, the recording?
Final Fantasy?
Yes.
Yeah, who doesn't love Final Fantasy?
It's lovely.
Yeah, well, it's, you know, what can I say? The music is so incredible. You know, there's such demanding music. It's so well written. I mean, the songs are so catchy and total earworms, and the orchestrations and the arrangements are incredible. Really beautiful orchestral lyrical stuff. And at the same time, you have really hard metal under it. And it's the music is very versatile. You know, you have really beautiful ballads and kind of more orchestral stuff, and then at the same time in the same game you'll have metal songs, you know, and rock songs and funk. It's very eclectic music, but all of it is extremely well written and produced. So it's a real joy to play this stuff. And we also played the music live. There is a thing called the Final Fantasy Fan Festa. Mm-hmm. Which is a, you know, live performances of the video game music.
Wow.
Which is even more exciting, of course, when you're not just, you know, doing it in the studio, but right. When you're actually, you know, on stage with a full orchestra performing the songs live, and then they're, you know, when we did it, they played scenes from the game on a big screen on the stage and everything. So it's a really incredible you know, performance, and the music is just absolutely wonderful. I love all this stuff.
Great. The final question is, what are the plans for the future of your producing and your music and teaching?
Well,
general.
I have many, many plans. I will continue to write and produce and record and play live and in the studio. It's kind of what I do every day at the moment. Of course, you know, there's really nothing going on live. So I focus on recording sessions and on producing and writing music, and also on my online school and on my other business on 9Beats USA. I have a franchise of drum schools and music schools here in America. And we are currently developing two apps for the App Store. So I spend a lot of time... And I work on that every day, you know, producing content for the app, and taking content from my drum universe to put on the app. Also licensing content from Hal Leonard and Hudson Music and Drum Guru and other companies to go on the app. So that takes a lot of my time to focus on the business, basically. And I continue to just... write music and play music I like and do a lot of recording sessions until hopefully the situation changes with the virus, you know, and it becomes possible to travel again and tour again.
Is there any chance that you come to Argentina to do a clinic or?
I hope so. I'd love to. At the moment, I can't travel anywhere, unfortunately, but yes, I will definitely come. I love Argentina.
Yeah. Well, so it has been an honor for me to make this interview.
My pleasure, Pablo. My pleasure.
And to know you kind of like personally.
Yes, exactly.
In a virtual way, but it's awesome. It's awesome.
Too. Well, I hope we get the chance to meet in person sometime soon.
Yes. I hope so. I hope so too. So
exactly.
Bueno, ha sido un gran placer tener a Thomas Lang acá en esta entrevista. Así que bueno, espero que les haya sido de mucha utilidad. Así que bueno, thanks a lot
Gracias.
Thomas, it's a pleasure. So
thank you. We keep in touch. I'll see you next time. Thank you.
Bye-bye. See you later.
Take care. Stay safe.